Thanks to the Institute of Advanced Studies for putting this night on. I think it's a really great thing the university does. So what I want to talk about today, as the title says, and I don't believe that at all, so hopefully I can present an argument by saying I think water flowing to the sea is very important for environmental, social and economic reasons. So hopefully I can turn your views around. Because as a freshwater ecologist, I've heard this line so many times, water going to the sea is totally going to waste. So, as I said, hopefully I can change your views. That slide you see up there, that's the Prince Regent River up in the Kimberley. And I'd like to use the Kimberley, especially the tropics, as an example of how we actually present this argument by saying water is actually really valuable when it flows to the sea. So why rivers? Clearly rivers are a really important part of our landscape. They're highly connected systems, they're sites of high biodiversity, not just for aquatic species, but also terrestrial species that use rivers. They're wildlife corridors. And as you can see, what I've done there in red is I've pointed out what's important to rivers to us. You know, what's called the ecosystem services. We're reliant on rivers for water, for food, for some medicines, and clearly an example of that in the far north Queensland, the tropics, really high aesthetic values as well. So I think rivers are really, really special parts of our landscapes. But what about, if rivers are important, then what, in terms of climate change, how will that impact on our river systems in Australia? This is an older slide, but I think it really shows it pretty well, where if you look at southwestern Australia, clearly we're going through a drying phase. The last 50 or 60 years, we've seen almost a halving of inflow to our reservoirs. We've seen temperatures rise by almost a degree. And we've seen the similar types of things, but the signal isn't quite as strong in the eastern states. So clearly the southern states of Australia are drying. We don't see that same pattern in the tropics. So the climate predictions of the tropics are quite noisy. We're not really sure if they're going to dry or not. So, but at the moment, the models are saying the tropics will probably stay the same as what they are now. And the tropics have a lot of water. Almost half of our water resources in Australia are in the tropics. And only 1%, so it's only got one major dam in the tropics, and that's Argyle Dam on the Ord. All the rest is what we call unregulated. Unregulated means there's no dams in place. These rivers are free to flow to the sea. So clearly this means eyes are looking north. We've got a drying southern part of the continent, lots more demand for water. We have a lot of water in the north with ideas it's going to waste. So clearly that generates ideas about canals. My pointer's gone to sleep. Canals from the north, bringing water, say, from the Fitzroy down to Perth to make our gardens look like England, or ideas they have in Queensland about turning some of the rivers back, the old Bradfield scheme, where reversing flow of our rivers back into back floods some of the dry areas. So clearly this idea about water going to waste is really strong in terms of how we manage our resources in Australia. So what happens when we dam a river? This is an example. This is the Kununurra Diversion Dam, again on the Ord. So when we dam a river, what we do is we change the way the river connects to its landscape. We change the way the river can flood in terms of how it inundates floodplains. We change the upstream-downstream links if we take water out of a system. And we change the way the river interacts with groundwater. But what I want to talk about now is how flows from a river are really important economically. Here what I've got is some data showing, it's about 50 or 60 years data. The blue lines represent flows coming out of the Fitzroy, the same catchment that Harry was talking about. So you can see there's peaks of floods across that 50-year, 60-year time period. And what I've done there is I've correlated catch of barramundi by staggering it 4 years. It takes barramundi 4 years to get up to commercial size. So after a flood, 4 years later, you get a large catch of barramundi. So clearly the water going to the sea is really important to drive this economic value in terms of the fisheries of barramundi. Same type of thing we see with prawns. Big flows, about a year or two later we see a massive increase in the prawn fisheries. That's because the big floods bring down all the nutrients, all the sediments, all the organic material, and that really drives this nearshore fishery. So clearly water going to the sea is not going to waste in this circumstance. It's really driving an important fishery. So what do these systems look like? Here's a range of our sites. Typically a tropical system has a main channel, obviously, has a range of different tributaries, and typically it'll have a lower down part in the catchment down towards the ocean. It'll have these floodplains and water holes. And this is the typical range of sites we sampled. We use the university research vessel, no expense spared, with our tropical explorer. We're very careful with university resources here, so we didn't spend that big. Anyway, we sampled the floodplains. We sampled the floodplains to find out what part of these landscapes are important to drive, fish production. essentially what we found here is most of the fish production comes from biomass, material food they pick up from the floodplain and the estuary. Very little comes from the river itself. So clearly when the water's on the floodplain and the fish are out there feeding, that's a really important process. And because we know these things are really highly linked systems, from the floodplains on your right there through the main channel, through the tributaries, then the fish have the abilities to move out this whole network. So it seems to us what happens, a lot of tracing techniques, what we found is that the fish put a lot of biomass in the floodplain, and then because they're migratory, they take this biomass upstream where they either die or get eaten by the species. So essentially the fish are feeding in the floodplains and subsidising other parts of the river network. So clearly the rivers, the floodplains of the rivers are very important. So flows which allow the flooding and inundation of floodplains are a really important process because they really drive the production of these fish, and then the fish move around and subsidise food webs elsewhere. Okay, really messy, I'm sorry, but what I'm trying to show here is we've got a range of sites across tropical Australia, from the Daly, which is the Northern Territory, the Mitchell in Queensland, the Fitzroy again, just north of here. And what I've shown here is that the Daly is really highly connected. So essentially it flows for 11 months of the year, and that contrasts, say, to the Fitzroy, which only flows for 1 month of the year. And all those plots show is the different types of food resources available for species living in these systems. So I'm looking at the bugs, the invertebrates, the crayfish, the fish, riparian spiders. And essentially what you can see here, in the Daly is a lot of noise. So what that means is lots of different types of food resources available for consumers in a highly connected system. And contrast that to the Fitzroy, where it's really quite simplified. There's only really a few food resources. So the analogy would be, I suppose, the fish in the Daly and all the other types of species you looked at, they're in a food hall. There's a whole different range of food they can eat, and that contrasts the Fitzroy, where they've gone home, there's one can of baked beans in the cupboard. So what that means then is a diversity of food resources, say in the Daly, can support a higher biodiversity of species. So again, Daly has really highly biodiverse, and that contrasts the Fitzroy. It's a really simplified system with only a few species. So clearly connectivity, links between the river, the floodplain, and upstream, downstream connections are really vitally important to maintain biodiversity in these systems. Again, clearly working in the north, working with Indigenous folks is really important. And what we've done here is try to link our Western science with some Indigenous knowledge about how these tropical systems work. Again, this is in the Fitzroy, which Harry spoke about before. But one of the products we came up with in trying to link Western science with Indigenous knowledge is this calendar. I hope this come out all right. This is a traditional Indigenous view about seasonality in the Fitzroy. So they recognise three major seasons and 13 sort of sub-seasons underneath that. And each of those sub-seasons is different species of plants and animals available to be harvested, to be eaten. So we've used that to base some of our monitoring programs to work out what species are available and when. And also a couple of slides I want to show you now. It's important in terms of Indigenous harvest. So this is, say, water holes in the Daly where Indigenous people have harvested turtles, lilies, barramundi. And with those plots here, you can see a smaller plot, which is consumption. So that's species which are caught and sort of eaten on the side of the pools. The other one's about harvest. So this is bush tucker, which is collected and then taken back to the community. So it's a really important part of their social interactions. It supports lots of sort of community engagement around this tucker. So a lot of the food's caught and eaten, but a great amount of that is actually distributed back in the community. So it becomes a really important part of, I suppose, their social links. And if we had to buy this in the shops, okay, you can't go to Woolworths and buy a long-necked turtle, but we benchmarked that against, a steak. So if you had to go and buy equivalent food, this is the sort of prices you'd be looking at. So clearly the bush tucker makes a significant contribution, not just the social interactions in Indigenous communities, but also the economic well-being. We're close on time, so this is my last slide, so I've done very well, Clarissa. Essentially what I say here is just to reiterate what I said initially. I believe that water flowing to sea is not wasted. Water flowing to sea has significant economic, environmental and cultural values. And hopefully I'll be able to show you, for example, the marine catch is re-reliant on flows flowing unregulated from a river to the sea, things like barramundi and prawns. The more linked a system is, the more important it is in terms of how it drives biodiversity. So again, flows would maintain connectivity between different parts of the river are important. Again, flows are important for Indigenous harvests. A couple of slides I've shown you before. And I think it's sort of a moral issue as well. If we take, say, water out of the Fitzroy to bring it south to Perth to maintain gardens look like England, then that really reduces the capacity for local people to be able to exploit water themselves and do things in their own catchment. So thanks for listening.